So our final presenter is James Collins, and James is coming to us today very much from the practitioner side of the equation. James has completed a master's degree from the University of Loughborough in the UK. He's also done the IOC Diploma in Sport and Exercise Nutrition. Over the last some 10, 15 years, he's worked with Olympic Sport on behalf of the English Institute of Sport, preparing athletes for Beijing, London, and Rio, and then has also worked extensively in football, most notably with Arsenal Football Club between 2010 and 2017, and also with the England football team in the build-up to the FIFA World Cup 2014. Today, he's going to be talking on his experiences on implementing the science in professional football. Please welcome James to the stage.
Thanks, James, for the kind introduction, and also for the invitation from James and from Ian, and for the GSSI for being able to speak here today. Now, as you mentioned, I'm going to come from a slightly different tack today. I'm coming from the practitioner angle, and my focus for the talk today is to really look at the different processes which I feel make a difference for the practitioner within the football club. And I think we need to be aware that the football environment is a very tough environment. We have lots of staff turnover, so I'd like to focus in on some of those details and processes which hopefully can allow the practitioner to develop and what I feel makes a difference to impact on the ground. Again, these are my opinions based on, you know, my experiences. So some of the things you might like, some of the things you might not, but I'm going to try and be quite honest with my views on certain things. And I guess I appreciate, you know, finally as well, it's the third session of the day, it's quite dark. And I heard there was a big night out last night, so I can see a few longer faces, so I'm going to try and keep it a little bit more punchy and upbeat too. So, just moving on then to the first slide. So here are the topics I'd like to discuss today. And firstly, it's about integrating the nutrition service and how that's integrated within the club and what the key stages are that I feel to integrate a nutrition service successfully. The performance landscape within football and what that consists of and how it's currently moving as well. And then also, what are the priorities when we're applying the science? How do we get our message? And as Graham mentioned earlier on, there's currently a disconnect. How can we work with the players to help motivate behavioral change and to get them to apply the best evidence possible? And then we're going to cover in a bit of detail, you know, how this is delivered. And then finally, we're going to boil down to a point which I think is really important within team sports, and that's winning the moments that matter. What are the key things to do within a club situation that keep you in a job and have maximum impact? So I'll give a little overview on myself. And, you know, my practice started with the English Institute of Sport prior to Beijing, so I'm very much from an institute background. I then joined Arsenal in 2010, and worked as head of nutrition there for seven seasons alongside Arsene Wenger. And that gave me a great opportunity to build a nutrition service over that period of time. The last World Cup I worked with England, and then since leaving them I've set up my practice in London and consult with different federations in Europe and also different clubs in the UK too. So one area I'd like to touch on first of all, it's very close to my heart, is I'm currently working as part of a team to put together the UEFA football nutrition consensus. And as we see from the dates here, if the clicker's working, this is the date of the last consensus. So our last best practice guidelines in football were back in 2006. That's 12 years ago. So as you can see, the rationale for working on these is quite clear. And these came together 2 years ago for a conversation with Dr. Alan McCall, who's head of research and development at Arsenal Football Club, Professor Ron Mon, who led the last consensus, and also Johan Bilsborough, who works at the Boston Celtics. And then we started the process of bringing together the leading applied practitioners and also the leading applied researchers, and we have a team of 23 in total to answer these questions and produce these best practice guidelines. And this is something UEFA have backed. Now, our rationale for doing this is in the dark blue box, and you can see, obviously, over the last 10, 12 years, the amount of research has evolved rapidly. And it's not just the breadth of subjects we're talking about within football, it's the depth now that we're going into with protein timings, with carbohydrate periodization. So we've got a solid rationale then. One of the things I'm going to touch on is that we're now facing increasing physiological demands during match play, which ultimately means that we have to prime our players to be able to fuel to meet those demands as well. And finally, evidence-based supplement use. We've just had the IOC position statement on supplements, and this is an area within football where there has never been so much pressure on our players, both from supplement companies, sometimes significant others, but we need to be able to give them a best practice so that we know we're giving them safe and also efficacious advice to support their performance. And finally, I know Professor Craig Sell delivered a presentation around maximizing rehabilitation, and how nutrition fits into that return to play pathway is obviously extremely key. And the next step for us with the consensus is publishing the manuscript after the World Cup, submitting that to British Journal of Sports Medicine, alongside a two-page practical guide too. And also, the next step is really to thank all of the contributors. Obviously, seeing the list, we've got a wealth of experience working on this project. So yeah, a huge thanks to Graham and to Ian who are in the room today, and also all the others who are contributing on this. So then, step one, integrating the nutrition service. The first thing I'd like to highlight is that unlike Olympic sports, and perhaps unlike rugby, nutrition services aren't developed within football. They aren't at the table. That's where we are at the moment. Medicine is more developed, and obviously more senior. Physiotherapy and strength and conditioning. We're against three very senior industries. So I think one of the things we need to recognize from the off is there are no best practice service models within football. And that's something we're working hard to address, but that's absolutely where we are. So how do we go about working within the sport? Because ultimately, if a club is recruiting a nutritionist, the people who are recruiting might not know what a best practice protocol looks like. So how do we protect ourselves and deliver a service over the long term? So here's the initial process that myself and my colleagues work with within clubs and federations. And you might be slightly surprised to see the top one, and that's a contract. If you work in professional football, at some point or another, you will get fired. You will get fired probably more than once. It doesn't mean you're doing a bad job. Staff change. And for me, the first and most important thing is to have a contract that's in place to start your program. And the first thing is to look at is, does the contract protect you? I've been amazed at the number of practitioners I've spoken to recently who start work without a contract in place. So if the manager goes tomorrow, you're out the door. I think the next stage with this as well is having someone with a legal background to look over that contract to make sure it protects you. There's no surprise at all that when a club drafts a contract, it's in their favor. There's no surprises at all. So you do have to have that difficult conversation at the start of the process, at the start of your contract, to push back on different terms. One of the standard terms which is in the contract for nearly all practitioners, and definitely nutrition, is immediate termination. Immediate termination. So you can be gone tomorrow. So I think for me to have some confidence and be able to build on the service, it's knowing that structurally that's in place first of all. And that's such a key point, I feel. And then the next is the needs analysis. And I think with nutrition, like most disciplines, if you're going into a new club environment, there's also a lot of pressure to roll up your sleeves and get on with it straight away. You're going to have managers that will come to you and they have body composition issues straight away that they want you to work on. Likewise, you're going to have fitness coaches that will want your advice on supplements or want your advice on periodizing training programs. But it's really important that we assess where we are going in. And so we assess where we are now at these different points over on the right-hand side. So especially looking, first of all, at the food service. How's the food service delivered? The number of chefs at the training ground, at the ground, and on the road, and what their process is and food hygiene is around preparing this food. And does their ethos marry to the ethos of the current practitioner at the club? These are really important first questions. The multidisciplinary team I feel strongly about, and I'm going to come on to that next. But also then is the players. And normally what will happen when you go into a club, you have the manager or you have the coach who will say, here are our key players, or here are the ones that are normally most interested in nutrition. I think it's really important to do an overall screen of all of the players when you're entering a club. And that might link into some of the hematological testing through the doctor. It might link into body composition testing, which has already taken place, but it certainly should link into either a diet recall or a dietary interview with yourself so you can see and assess the landscape. Finally, looking at different policies and protocols, what monitoring is taking place, and also the current policies for recovery, for travel nutrition, for match day nutrition, and how those different systems are managed on the ground. And finally, and this shouldn't be the case, but it absolutely is, it'll be looking at what the position is on the supplement policy. I've been into numerous sports and numerous football clubs where there's been supplements in the dressing room, on the counter in the middle, micronutrients, which are unlabeled, and on a counter, and we have no batch certificates next to these. We have no way of checking whether due diligence has been followed with these at all. So straight away, to protect the club and to protect the players and any risk of an anti-doping rule violation, the supplement policy would then go towards the top of the agenda for this needs analysis. And I think when we have that document, the next stage is then having a conversation with those who are line managing us. This might be the head of performance, it might be the head of medical services, and then putting together what this service plan looks like. And this service plan really is the fundamental framework for our season. Because just like a coach is expected to plan a periodized program over the season, just like S&C will do the same, I think with nutrition we have to be able to do that. We have to be able to show them when our monitoring is going to take place during the season. That might only be at four time points. It might be at the start and end of pre-season, mid-season at the end. But if we know that and we know other questions, for example, for a lot of Champions League clubs, we know a lot of fixture congestion and under-recovery might occur in November, December. So that's when we might want another block of monitoring with our players. But if we can start to piece together what the season looks like, we're then giving the people who are employing us a lot more confidence that we're delivering a service. We're not working directly with the players. We're delivering a service over a year. And then also, what do years two and three look like? What's the progression like of the service as well? Because clubs have money. They don't like to spend it, but they have money. And they need to know that when a practitioner goes in, this is what year one looks like. What does year two, year three, and year four look like? And that's how we start to get service growth. And finally, this for me is, obviously everyone's seen a multidisciplinary team slide before, but this is the most important slide that I'll show today. And obviously we have the player in the middle. Players are the most important people at the club. And then around the outside, we have the key service providers. Now, as a nutrition provider, we have to have a relationship with each of those people around the circle. I mean, normally, the closest relationship might well be with the fitness coach. And we've discussed earlier today about working closely to periodize nutrition, to understand the loading patterns. That's absolutely key. On clinical issues, it might well be the doctor. More and more now, nutrition is becoming part of coming to the table and becoming part of the conversation with return to play. So that's where the physios come in too. And typically in a club environment, this will run from a multidisciplinary team meeting before the players come in. And this is the opportunity where nutrition links in to answer the questions that the other staff members have. An honest reflection from myself is that I feel earlier in my career I didn't invest enough time into making all those people in that circle understand what the role of nutrition was. Because I think the better they understand, everyone in that circle understands, the more business they're going to send to you, the more integrated your service is going to become. The more integrated the service is, the more impact you will have. And I think my final point and reflection on this as well is this guy at the top of the chain. Normally the alpha male of the club runs the show. Early in my career as well, I probably didn't spend as much time working with the manager. The approach was normally, look, James, you go on and see the players, you work with the team, and you know I'm happy. As long as nothing happens, I'm fine. In the last post working with Arsene Wenger, I had someone that would do an education session stood next to you. You know, I would have someone that would want to talk to you in front of the players. As soon as you've got that, the players are listening because they know nutrition's important. You're talking in a meeting and you're sharing an education session, they know it's important. So one of the things, and my advice to all the practitioners I work with, is immediately have a relationship with the manager. It's absolutely critical that you have that. And don't get me wrong, you're going to have to push for this because people in football clubs like to protect the manager because he yields the power and ones close to him protect him and yield the power too. So it is a very political game at times, but I think it's crucial to develop a service and have longevity in a club. I think it's crucial to have a relationship with the manager. So we talked a little bit about growing the service and then changing tack slightly. Nutritionist normally goes into the club as a first-team appointment, which is absolutely right. That's where the funding comes for the post. Now, I think the next stage is normally that academy requires service and the ladies' team requires service too. In my last role at Arsenal, this happened quite quickly. So it gave me opportunity to bring other practitioners into the club, both at the academy level and with the ladies, and also to utilize the testing services from GSSI, from Rebecca and from Ian as well, which were a huge help at that time. The other point I would note on this is, here's one area where the landscape has changed. Performance chefs. 10 years ago, we did not call them performance chefs. They were very, very spiky individuals who yielded a lot of power and weren't particularly performance related in what they were offering. I can't remember the amount of times I've been told to F off in front of players by some older school chefs, and that's the truth. But more recently, we've got a newer range of chefs, of practitioners who are very well versed in nutrition and want to apply the principles that we're giving them, which is great. I think in a club situation, you can be looking after around five chefs, two at the training ground, two at the ground, and normally a travel chef, which is a lot to manage. I think aligned to this now, we're seeing a growing trend within football recently that we have external chefs or personal chefs that work with the players in their houses. This was something I resisted for a long time, because as practitioners, we're taught to educate the players, to work with the chefs and put on workshops for them. And it was something I resisted and thought, well, actually, if it's well managed, they can offer a good service to the players. My one reflection on this now, after doing this for a few years, is I absolutely feel that external chefs need to be managed by the club. They absolutely need to be managed by the club. So that makes it a very big catering operation, but I feel it has to happen. One, because we have the quality assurance. Two, we understand that the philosophies are aligned, and we can make sure there's no issues that arise from that too. So this is another really growing and important area. And finally, then on the ground. We often hear that we're moving too fast, or as practitioners, we're working fast and working slow. And this paper highlighted by Aaron Coots on the right-hand side is, I think, a really important shift for me. And it really summarizes how, as practitioners, we're working very fast. We work very intuitively with players to provide solutions. But we also, when we have research embedded, we have someone who's working in a slow way, someone who helps to validate our practices. And that was something earlier in my career that I didn't focus on as much. And since meeting good researchers in the field and working very closely with them, they've added enormous value to the work we deliver on the ground as well. So I find that extremely important. I think the other thing to really note as well is, from this picture at the bottom, this is from the English Institute of Sport. And this is something they do really well, and that is technical support or supervision. Now, that's built into your week when you work in an institute program, to have someone there who's on your level to discuss the hard cases with. And I think in football, we have a lot of these too. Sometimes technically they're not the challenge, but they will put you ethically in some compromising situations, and it's really important to have someone that you can bounce ideas off of and share practice. Sometimes we call this supervision. I think supervision conjures the image of a very senior person looking down on a junior practitioner. I don't think that's necessarily the case with good supervision. I think it happens where people are sharing ideas and best practice and keeping each other on track. And I think one of the things we have to resist as practitioners is when we're working very fast in clubs and we're working across multiple contracts, this can be the one thing that we drop. We lose our network and we become isolated as a practitioner. And I think that, when we become isolated, becomes dangerous, because then we lose sight and lose the quality of some of our work and our decision making. So I think these two points are really important too. So then, changing tack slightly and looking at the performance landscape, we know very well that every national team and every club will have a very different ethos, it'll have a different culture, and it'll be made up very differently. Now, quite typically, some of the demands that we face as we enter a club, as practitioners, look like this. You know, some of our elite players now will play over 60 games a season, both domestically, and clubs in the Champions League will play internationally and also Champions League fixtures. So it's not just the fact that we're playing domestic fixtures, it's the fact that our top talent are traveling around the world to play with their national teams too. I think there's often the thought that footballers have it quite easy, but they're playing for 11 months of the year. Again, if you're a top player playing for a top international team, your downtime, your time off, might be limited to 2 or 3 weeks after a season. It's actually not very much, when you come to think of it. It's actually not very much to get your headspace out. Physically, yeah, you can recover, absolutely, but to have that time away with your family and to unwind, it isn't a huge amount. And we've got domestically the amount of cups you're challenged for. The amount of flights will be 30-plus, obviously a lot more, and a lot more travel fatigue from long-haul travel for our international players. And squad sizes really vary. And typically, I've worked with some big squads and some smaller squads too. But I think one of the things that we are definitely seeing and does impact our practice is that the demographic of our squads is changing. Since the Bosman ruling in 95, we're seeing greater cultural migration of players. Teams since 95 look completely different. If we just look at the numbers there, we have in 1995, 18% of the top five European leagues were made up of foreign players. In 2015-16, this number was up to 46%. In the Premier League, at this time, it was 66%. And you might say, okay, so what? But for us as practitioners, we're then having to work with up to 16 different nationalities in the first team squad, which is extremely difficult, because when we're looking at how we tailor our message and how we provide feedback, there needs to be a hell of a lot of detail going into those strategies. The other thing is, culturally, with our chefs need to be across and working with us to help orientate these players and provide foods that they're going to eat. It's all very well for us being very narrow with our food selection and our philosophy at the club and say we do things this way. But if we have a younger player coming from Brazil or from Chile or from somewhere else in South America and they won't eat the food we're putting on, we've got an issue because they're going to go outside of the system. So we need a degree of flexibility too. And for me, this point on cultural migration is one of the growing points that's going to keep running and running. And it's something we have to be across as practitioners. I think one of the things we don't do well in football at the moment is the crosstalk between national team and club team. It doesn't happen nearly well enough. And that's not just with nutrition, that's with S&C and that's with medicine too. We have some countries that will talk very well with club and country, and that's great. And we can understand what's happening on a camp. But if we think about the World Cup at the moment, there'll be lots of testing and strategies put in place by different international teams. To ensure we've got continuity with what goes on in the clubs, this crosstalk needs to improve as well. So applying the science, what are the priorities? So then going back to our UEFA consensus, this sort of explosion of colour here is highlighting the key themes that we're going to be covering within the consensus. Now, the top two here, training nutrition and match nutrition, are obviously our biggest strategies, covering fueling, recovery, body composition as well, and also fixture congestion. But one of the key points that we were keen to work on with this piece of work is listening to the practitioners and clubs and federations in the field, and this is where we developed this special consideration section to answer the questions that a lot of clubs and federations have. Now, the questions that came for them were applying nutrition around travel. This might be short-haul travel, or this might be long-haul travel to major tournaments as well, to give more advice and thoughts to back that up. On the immunity side, we've got Mike Gleason who's heading this, but also we've had feedback from different federations that they want more information on food hygiene. That it's all very well talking about the immunonutrition side and the technical side, but a lot of clubs don't know how we should put food out in the dressing room. A lot of clubs aren't sure how we should heat food when it goes on the road, or what's happening at the training ground. And it's a pretty fundamental thing. And it's only as the process has gone on, we've got more feedback that's right. And I think there is a disconnect sometimes between the best practice advice, let's say in immune and nutrition, and also some of these really practical principles that will make the difference. And I think it's in this area, really understanding and listening to the federations and trying to answer these questions, that will yield the performance benefit. So then zooming in on fueling in more detail. Now, one of the ways that we might explain this to the players is that this is being borrowed from Stephen Covey on the business side, but getting our big rocks in place first of all. Where are the positions that players need to focus their time and their energy first of all? Now, I would argue that, first of all, players need to be fueled for training and matches. The recovery from training sessions and matches as well is obviously critical. And one point we often overlook is that's ensuring that there's no nutrient deficiencies, both macro and micronutrient, in our training diet. There's no holes that we haven't picked up on, and that we're eating a wide range of foods too. So I think it's critical with our players that they understand that we're getting the big rocks in place, and also we're not being sidetracked chasing along things that might not have an impact. So fueling, Graham covered this in a huge amount of detail early on, and I think that's absolutely right. There's some great work coming out of Liverpool John Moores now. We've learned a lot more around the fueling for match days and also for training days too. And the paper on the left-hand side has really highlighted these increased in high-speed loading on match days. So we're having to fuel our players to be able to cope with these demands too. And I think the role of the practitioner here is, along this sliding scale, we're working with them to, in the preparation for match, on the match day minus one, the match day, and the match day plus one, how can we influence the players to increase their carbohydrate intake at those times? And likewise, when there are recovery days, how can we influence them to reduce their carbohydrate intakes accordingly? And I think that really is the key question. So one of the practical challenges that we face around answering these questions on match day comes from our kickoff times. In 2005, we see the amount of kickoff times on the left-hand side. 10 years later, we see that there's over 30% more kickoff times. So for players, these are creating more questions for them. It's more difficult to plan. Due to the commercial nature of the sport, the traditional lunchtime, mid-afternoon and evening kickoffs have merged. And then we've now got kickoffs almost every hour. Now, what are the big challenges then for our players? Well, as Graham commented on earlier on, we know that this morning kickoff provides a huge challenge for players to fuel appropriately. If they're not doing well enough anyway, when in their eyes they've got one feeding at 8:30 or 9 o'clock in the morning, it's a huge challenge for them. And it's something that they admit they would really struggle with this first meal and this first feeding. And this is something we need to work with them and work with the chefs to help coach them to improve this area. Likewise, in the evening, for the evening kickoffs around 8 o'clock, we know there's a challenge between players to refuel after those matches. So again, it's up to us to work with them on practical strategies to help deliver the carbohydrate after the match and start this recovery process too. And at both ends, we know it's not being done well enough yet. So how is this being delivered?
James, you've got about 2 minutes, I reckon.
Okay, great. I'll whistle through these. So how is this being delivered? So one of the key points that I believe is that we as nutritionists coach players. We build a long-term relationship with players, we have touch points with them each day, and we're directing them to a longer-term goal. We hear a lot about in clubs about education. The players need education. But what does that education look like? I believe this is a coaching process like an S&C coach works, and also like a coach works too. And I think I would say along this process as well, there are different tools which I think can help motivate change. Something the Institute were big on was motivational interviewing and using those tools to create elicit change in behavior. Likewise, I know there's some excellent work from Nessan Costello and the group at Leeds looking at different behavior change models as well within nutrition. And I think that's the sweet spot. I think it's for us to find ways to motivate change for our players. And then the final point on this slide was that's my insights profile on the top there. And it was something that I actually found helped a lot. It was something that a few clubs invested in with their sports psych, just to understand how you perceive the world as an individual, how I communicate, but also how different individuals like to receive information. And definitely in the past, there'd be times where you wouldn't be able to get on with a player, and there'd be a bit of a disconnect. That's definitely helped to unlock personalities as well. And I think that's a really valuable tool. I'm really conscious of time, so I'm going to whistle through this. This is a point we raised earlier on. When environmental cues are on the wall for long periods of time, they become wallpaper. They become something that needs to change. All of our cues in clubs, if we're looking to elicit behavior change and looking to nudge players in the right direction, these need to change on a particular day that the player's inside a club. Players are creatures of habit. They're used to seeing the same things. These things need to change. And I think the other point I would make on this too is with the players, we're looking for them to lead this change. We're not looking to blindly give them drinks. We want players to be decision makers. We want to upskill players to be thoughtful, because ultimately, they're deciding what goes into their body. And when they're working with their national team, they need to make these decisions when we're not around to advise them as well. So we need to develop independent, thoughtful players. I've got about 1 minute, James.
Yep.
And then looking at match days, again, I think the key thing for me is affecting players on match days. It should be the easiest thing in the world to get right, post-match food. It took about 5 years to get a strategy we were satisfied with. And I think the two key factors are quality and location. I think one of the factors that holds us back, especially in the Premier League, is that outside catering companies often own the rights to a lot of the grounds, which really limits what we can do. It was only when we broke that contract that we could really get the quality players are used to. Unless it's the quality they'll eat out in a restaurant and it's providing after the match, compliance drops right off. That's what we found. And likewise, the same with the location. Now these changing rooms are enormous. You've got three almost large atriums that form a changing room. Unless the food is in harm's way, right next to the players that are getting changed, we found compliance drop right off. Again, sometimes there's some fights with kit men and managers to make this happen, but the location of this is absolutely critical to get the buy-in. And targeted use of sports foods as well. I won't dwell on this one because we're running out of time. And I think finally for me, this really boils down to winning the moments that matter, and I think that coaches in professional football clubs look at practitioners and consultants a similar way they look to players, and that's, can they deliver under pressure? Because I think ultimately us as practitioners, we can go along doing a good job. We can engage most of the squad, 80%. We can change some behavior. But it's often when the manager has a question that's important to them They're looking for us to solve that and solve it quickly. If we succeed at that, then we've demonstrated our effectiveness. If we haven't, then I think, unfortunately, there's consequences to that too. So I think it's always being aware of being able to win those moments that matter, and even if they're not questions that are important to us as practitioners. And I realize I've gone a little bit over time, but here's my conclusion today and for applying a service working within a football club. I feel that the role of the nutritionist in elite football requires them to deliver a long-term service plan, embedding the nutrition service within the multidisciplinary team, and addressing individual nutrition priorities whilst answering the key performance questions of the club.